that's AI, right? And so I do that globally. I've done that for many people in my business. So I'll tell you everything about salary negotiation, about branding, about interview prep, how to measure your skills against the market, your hard skills, your soft skills. So a little bit of background. I've placed a lot of people in the tech space because there's no other space, and I've done that mostly in Europe, but also in San Francisco, where I was living before, and that's where I met Adriana, to give a bit of background. That's where we started our journey together, and she came to my workshop, and I then started to help place all the people that finished her coding school, that at the time was way smaller than today. It was easier to manage. Now you are so many. I think she puts through 500 people per year. So that's pretty impressive. 1 year can change your life. And how do I do that? Optimization of your LinkedIn, optimization of your CVs and profiles online, because you don't exist unless you exist online. And the content creation, I also do that sometimes for my clients. It's not a must, but it does help. You don't have to be an influencer. But I try to measure this through the analytics tools that we have on mostly LinkedIn. That's where I'm most present. So how do we measure talent? So as a recruiter, as a headhunter, as a career coach, we judge people through their CVs, and we do it fast, their LinkedIn profiles, and we look at your titles, what you've done in the past, and it should be somewhat consistent to what you want to do in the future. The CV is more about your past, and the LinkedIn is more about what you can offer. So we try to keep it short, so your title can be, you know, back-end or front-end or full-stack developer, depending on what your specialty is, or DevOps or cybersecurity. I don't know what your background is, but you want to make it understandable to most, so you don't want to just talk to your industry, your peers. You have to be mindful of the fact that headhunters are not tech. You know, we understand it, but not as well as you do. So make your titles understandable to most, and cover not just, you know, a country. So let's say I speak two languages and I'm a personal assistant. It's important to state it in the title. So like bilingual personal assistant, just add that in, or a global manager instead of regional or country management, so that people understand how big, because this is what we measure, how big of a region, how big of a, three things, right? So how big of a budget, how big of a region, how close you are to reporting to the top management of your company, and by the title, that's how we assess it. And avoid those chief energy officers titles that are a bit funky and don't really explain much. So in terms of like measurements, how much money you spent or raised or helped fund, we look at people who have, you know, top voices, or 30 under 30, 40. Of course, it's an advantage, but if you don't have to be, you know, an influencer. In terms of experience, we look at people who have experience from, you know, 5 to 7 years up to 15. We don't want people too experienced, because that's too expensive and too heavy, and we're not so attracted to those more super senior. Unfortunately, we privilege the young. So what I try to do is, if I see somebody who has, you know, 25, 30 years of experience, we have to sort of transform their CV and LinkedIn to make them look as young and fresh as possible. Social proof and endorsement. We like to see, you know, X this, or X Amazon, or X Yahoo, or X Google, or if you don't have any X, it's fine, you don't have to. But you can mention that on your headline on LinkedIn. So we're looking at hard skills. Hard skills are transferable skills. These are skills that have something to do with, for example, stakeholder management, fundraising is one of them, client engagement, business development. And today, when it comes to tech, jobs. We want the full package. We really want people who understand the technology, but who also understand how to cater to clients and serve them and acquire them and maintain them. And we can't have people who are not capable of doing business and only doing the technology. So we really want that double edge. So be mindful of that. Think about the four skills or five skills that define you best today. And I mean, I'm not talking about programming language. I'm talking about the skills that you have that are engaging and that are attractive for business owners. Whether it's, I mean, artificial intelligence is a separate, that's a tech, that's a tool, right? So we're not talking about tools, we're talking about, you know, client engagement, product development, project management, transferable skills that you can use. Those are competencies that you can use in different industries. Business development, sales. Make sure you have that clear for yourself. It's not so easy to map it out here on the go. I'll help you. Reach out to me on LinkedIn, and I will give you the next step. So we need to understand what are your drivers. So, oh, I just want to make more money than in my last jobs. That's a terrible driver. So we won't accept that as a wow factor. So we want someone who wants to leave a legacy, who wants to transfer knowledge. We want people who are looking to build something of value, right? So we're really looking for that kind of extra motivation. And we do look at like the extra work that you're doing on top of your 9-to-5. If you have projects, mention them. If you have been very active on your social media, you know, mention the amount of followers, or even if you're like running marathons or whatever it is you're doing on the side, it's important that you highlight those extras, even if it's not in your current job description. We map it through this type of tool. So we do a lot of personality assessments. And I mean, we HR, you know, headhunters, recruiting, we like to understand your soft skills, not just your hard skills, because they really help us see whether you have a future in the company, whether you're going to be able to, if there's longevity in your profile, if you're going to just take what's best here and then go somewhere else after you've been trained. We try to understand, so like I said, if you're leaving a legacy, if you're looking for social justice, if you're looking to provide structure and optimize things, if you're looking to to learn, and everyone is looking for something different, and we're able to determine that drive through the assessments. And then values, I know it sounds a little bit, do you really need that? Well, yes, because it depends a lot on the company culture, right? If you're going for a culture that is more aggressive and competitive, then you know your value you should have those aligned values. If you're going for a company that's all about sustainability and diversity, then you have to live by those standards yourself. And it's hard to fake it. You really will be caught if you're not in that same spirit, right? So map it out, be really honest with yourself, and then honest also with the interviewer, right? And of course you can say my value is massive wealth, that's okay. So look for companies who are in that space, right? So depending on the values that you choose to live by, and they can change over time, and they do change over time, maybe just map maybe the 10 values that are most important for you here. It's not easy because there's so many of them. We did that exercise together with our mastermind group. Adriana and Karen are here today. We're part of this group of ladies who are constantly rethinking their positioning and their brand. Community matters, as Adriana stated. So this is something that will be reflected in your soft skills, in your CV, in your LinkedIn. We can smell it, we can figure it out during the interview, we can very much track it down, we can measure it, and it's showing in the personality assessments as well, because we have very modern ones these days. So your profile picture, I just wanted to talk about that, because some of you have different pictures, and I just want to harmonize this. So we want to have high quality, good profile pictures, right? With no kids, no sunglasses, not just your face, but you know, up to your chest. No drinks unless you're selling, you know, wine, and that's fine if that's your product. But just, you know, not a party picture, not something that you cropped out of some other, you know, photos. So you really want to be intentional. I would say invest in a nice, decent profile picture that you'll put in the resume and also in the LinkedIn profile. And if you're applying for a US, Canada, UK, then you don't want to put pictures there, right, on the CV. It's just for Central Europe. Yeah, they don't like it. And then also your background. So on LinkedIn you have two pictures. You have your picture and then your background picture. So here you can put, for example, your slogan. And this is something we build carefully with our clients when we do assess their hard skills and soft skills, their drivers, their motives and purpose. We really scan them and get to, okay, what's your I'll give you some examples. Like I was working with this guy. He is a chef, and he wanted to stop being a chef and work as a product development manager, director in the food industry. So from the kitchen to the office, from the weekends to weekdays. And you know, I mean, he's a chef, right? He didn't necessarily go to university. What we came up with was, well, I'm scaling sustainable culinary innovations, because he could just say I'm a chef, or I'm a cook, or I like food, or I work in a restaurant. That doesn't define you. What defines you is that dreamy slogan, right? Like you go to Disney, it's the happiest place on earth. Swarovski, ignite your dreams. Nike, just do it. Adidas, impossible is nothing. They all have their own slogans, and they're dreamy slogans. They're promises of delivering something of value, and you have to be that brand for yourself, even if it's a bit of an overstatement. And it has to be, because Disney is not the happiest place on earth. It's the place where you have to wait in line forever, right? So you have to not be so realistic about it. You actually want to be a bit dreamy about your slogan, and it's a combination of your hard skills and your drivers, your motivation, your purpose. And then, you know, that can be, that's the conversation starter for interviews. You know, if you start the interview with, hi, I am Jim, and I like to scale sustainable culinary innovation. Okay, tell me about how. Well, I do this with project management tools, with product development strategies and innovation, you know, procedures, and I've mapped it all out. Let me give you an example. Okay, and then when? And then you go down, when I did it with Burger King, I created this really great salsa that we commercialized, and it went well, and it's a success now, and everybody is loving it. So then, you know, you start from the conceptual, and then you go down to the more detailed examples of what you concretely did. So, so that's usually what goes in your background on LinkedIn. So one thing that we also look is if you have above 500 people on LinkedIn as connections, because that's when we consider you to be complete. LinkedIn will also rank you higher and be nicer to you if you have that. So try to get to 500. The maximum you can get to is 30,000, but followers is infinite. So. Let's talk a little bit about salary. I really get a lot of questions about salary, so I want to make sure that I share this with you here. I have my sort of sacred rules for what salary negotiation means, and it's nothing more than salary customization. It's not so much a negotiation, it's adapting to your profile. I mean, you're just a product on the market of talent, and there's a price for your skills, and you need to be clear about it. It's important that you always negotiate, always, always, always negotiate, always customize, always. There's no exception to that. And we always use the word fair when we're trying to talk through our new package. Is it fair that I should be in this position for this amount of money, covering this much ground, these many people, this big of a region, all these important clients? Do you think that's fair? So when you talk like that, people listen. It's good, it's good. So we never ask for anything in writing because it's too easy to say no. If you say, I need more time, I need more money, in writing, I can just email you back with a no. It's very comfortable. So I never ask for more in writing. I do that on the phone in a meeting. And then I confirm what we just agreed in writing, right? Then, oh, as we agreed, you know, you upgraded me to business class. That's fantastic. I'm going to move on and book my ticket. So you that's a really important negotiation technique. I think it's important to understand there's two different stakeholders when you're negotiating salary. One is your future boss and one is HR. HR is more about you know, the benefits, you know, like your social security, your health care plan, your pension, your insurances, your car. They are only on the benefit side of things, and they negotiate for the whole company in bulk. So it's not a one by one. They negotiate for the whole company. We're gonna get Toyota for everybody. Right, and if you come and you ask for a Tesla, no, I'm sorry, because then I have to change everybody else's car, so it's not going to happen. But salary, shares, equity, bonus, commission, that's the hiring manager, your boss. So that person is the one who can decide, and that's the person who holds the budget, who has the authority to release that money, you know. So it's that person that you need to talk to when you're talking salary, so just to make that understanding. You know, who is holding what in terms of stakeholder, right? So some people will have relocation needs. So if you're, for example, applying for a job in Switzerland and you're living here and you need them to support your relocation, that's also possible in many cases, actually. So that's something that is negotiated on a case-by-case. This is very much on a case-by-case basis. So it's very customized to you and your family setting. Are you bringing kids, dogs? Are you coming alone? Are you coming with your girlfriend, your boyfriend? So we take into account the taxes in the new setup. You have to, because it changes everything. Like, I had this client, she was American, married to a German. She was living in Amsterdam. She was moving now to Switzerland. Like, her tax was a mess, right? I mean, it's really intense. And it can really impact the final... the money that comes in at the end of the month, right? So you need to take that into account. You also can revisit the numbers that you gave initially to people in the conversation that you have. You can first say, okay, well, I would like to make 100K, and then you advance in the selection process, and at the end you realize, no, actually 100K is not enough for all the responsibilities you want me to take on. This is too much. I mean, too little. So then you can say, listen, I said 100 in the beginning, but now I know you better. I think it's 110 or 120. So you can really have that flexibility. Don't stay married to anything unless you sign, right? Then it's a different factor. But anyway, so location, yes, is the main factor when we decide the size of the salary. The location is really what matters in terms of. So people in Switzerland are making more money than people in Spain. It's just the location. It's not the skill set. It's not the languages they speak, the schools they went to. Location is really a big factor in determining how much you're going to make. So this is another thing that I find efficient when we're negotiating. Well, add more responsibilities if you want more money. So yes, you're telling me I have to help you with client retention. Why don't I help you with client acquisition, right? I can also develop business for you, and then this will result, automatically you're offering more. So if you're offering more value, you can now open the conversation to, in this case, what would my salary or my commission or my bonus look like if I'm doing more than what you're asking me? So you can offer to do more in order to make more, and this has been a successful strategy as well. Or even sometimes, that's a friend of ours, Stephanie, did this in one of her interviews. She was interviewing for a B2C job, as in she was going to be an employee, but then she decided to offer her services as a B2B because she has a company and that was going to be more lucrative for her. So she transformed the interview into a conversation about you know, her as a vendor rather than her as an employee. So that's something that can also happen, and it's sometimes to your advantage depending on your setup. You want to be seen not for, you know, greedy, or you don't want to be that person who is just interested in more money. You want to be that person who wants to add more value, and then it translates into more money. I just want to talk about sign-on bonus. This is very common, and it happens to a lot of people, actually, because if I leave now, I'm going to leave a lot of money on the table because my old employer, you know, he was supposed to give me my bonus in April, but now if I go and meet you in February, I'm going to leave all this money on the table. Can you meet me halfway? So you get that kind of setup if you can prove that last year you made 30K, this year you're probably going to make 30K again, then I want to hire you fast. I don't want to wait until May. I want to hire you now in February. I'll give you the 30K, but then you stay with me for 2 years, 3 years. So you commit to that long, you know, loyalty of okay, I'm making sure that you sign fast and you stay with me 2-3 years, and you have those arrangements that are quite common. Counter offers, it's like, okay, I'm leaving, and then your boss is like, no, you're not, you're staying, I'll give you more money. It happens a lot, and I don't think it's a great career strategy. I think in the long term, your boss is just trying to find a good replacement for you, and he will be the one, or she will be the one, to kick you out when the time is more optimal for them. So don't count on counter offers. They're a terrible way of moving forward in your career. So I think there's notice period. People don't understand sometimes those concepts, like what is a notice period, what is a non-compete, non-solicitation. Maybe it will come to you, right? Depending on the job that you do, depending on the industry you're in. Non-competes are, so notice period is how much time you need to give to your employer before you leave, and it's the same time that he or she needs to give you in order to fire you, right? So in Switzerland it's 3 months. I don't know exactly. Here I think it's about a month. US is 2 weeks, and every market is different. Non-compete is, you know, if I work for a competitor, I'm not able to go, and if I leave the company, not if I'm fired, but if I leave, I'm not allowed to go and work for the direct competition. I have to wait for at least 1 year in order to do that. So that is a problem, and sometimes really does make things difficult for us career coaches and headhunters. And there's another element also, like for example, I have a client, he works for a company that is really well known in Switzerland, and he wants to work with headhunters to be placed in a different company, but the headhunters all have contracts with this company, and so they won't touch him because that's against their contract, right? So, oh, sorry, I can't touch you because you're my client. I mean, you work for a company that is my client, so I can't take you out of there. So sometimes this happens. Non-solicitation is usually 2 years, right? Like, it means that if I'm leaving to a new job, I can't take all my colleagues with me to the new location. I have to wait 2 years in order to make that happen. So these are typical restrictions. If you want to know more about salary negotiation, I really recommend Chris Voss. He's a great negotiator, and he wrote a very practical, applicable guide, and I've followed his guidelines precisely and carefully, and it does work. So I think it's to negotiate everything. I mean, not just salary. So that's the book that I go by. Quiz time. Wow, that was fast. Okay, so we still have time. Where is my helper? I'm not sure you, well, I think you did pay attention to everything. Let's see, we're gonna test you another. Two questions only. Okay.
I have you. Okay, yo propongo una cosa.
Okay.
Y es que para como no hay unos mandos para ver quién responde antes, bueno, decimos cuál es el premio.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Es.
So we were looking for 40 people to hire in Madrid, and we want to hire them fast. We have 4 months, 40 people. That's a lot. You know, normally we hire not so fast. Can you do it? I'm like, I think so. If we partner with Adriana and Fernando, maybe. Essentially, we're distributing jobs today, tech jobs in the entertainment space. I'll give you more details, but feel free to bombard me on LinkedIn, send me everything about you and your CVs so that we can prioritize you first, because you are my priority in Madrid.
Oh, ¿no? ¿Te gusta? En resumen, un coacheo especial personalizado, que esto además vale una pasta. ¿Cómo lo haremos? Lanzas la pregunta y yo voy a supervisar quién levanta la mano más rápido. Y si hay muchas manos, será el que antes llegue al escenario. No, es que soy tímido. Ah, pues hay que espabilar en la vida, amigo. Adelante.
Ok.
Atención, pregunta. ¿Cuáles son los pasos iniciales para elevar tu marca personal en LinkedIn? A. Optimización de contenido análisis. B. Optimización y contenido. C. Contenido y análisis. Levante la mano antes. Por allá atrás tengo una mano. Aquella ha sido... Yo he visto la primera allá atrás. La chica de... También, ¿no? Vale. Espera, no. Vamos a hacerlo. ¿Os acordáis de cómo era, no? El primero. La primera que llegue al escenario, o el primero, será... Es que si no es imposible.
Sí. Oh, yeah.
Okay. ¡Tiempo! ¡Venga, va! ¡Esa música arriba! ¡Energía! ¡Eso es!
More passion.
A lo mejor no responde correctamente. Yo que tú vendría, por si no...
So
A, B o C.
It's A. She's right. She's right.
Yeah. ¿Lo vemos?
Yeah. Yeah. It's...
¡Correcto! Por lo tanto, ¿cómo te llamas?
Oh, you are. Oh, my God, that's amazing. Oh, she's awesome.
¿Cómo te llamas?
Mónica.
Mónica, ¿de dónde?
Bueno, vengo de Two Finder, también soy reclutadora.
¿También es reclutadora? Bueno, pues sí. Os vais a entender. Enhorabuena. Luego nos ponemos en contacto contigo y dispondrás de un cocheo a cargo de Rebeca. Ya sé que es un poco injusto el que está en el medio, no sé qué, pero esto hay que espabilar. Siguiente pregunta.
Yeah, next one.
¿Negociamos el salario como director de contratación y los beneficios con recursos humanos? ¿Esa frase es falsa o verdadera? Corred aquí, yo ya no he visto nada. Corred aquí, el primero que llegue. El primero que llegue. ¡Oh, amigo! ¿Cómo desempatar esto, Rebeca? Rebeca, ¿cómo es?
There's enough for everyone. So, yes, it's correct.
Ah, bueno, espera, que...
Oh! I'm sorry.
Hay que perfeccionar esto el año que viene. ¿Tú qué dices? Sí, es correcto.
It's correct, absolutely.
Pues tú dirás, Rebeca, ¿qué hacemos?
No, so, like I said...
Yo pasaba por aquí.
No, that's it. That's all I have for you. Two questions.
¿Y a quién se la damos? ¿Al más mayor de los dos?
No, a los dos.
¿A los dos?
Yeah.
¡Ole!
Just ping me on LinkedIn and harass me today and I'll be here all day. I'm completely committed to this crowd. I've seen you grow, because I was in the first 2017 meeting with Douglas, and I've seen how this community has been only solidifying itself in terms of quality, and I just can't wait to place you all. Get to work.
¿De dónde venís? Rápidame, de Madrid. ¿Y de? ¿Y nombre era?
David.
Igual que antes te llamas. Sí. Y Jorge David. Y Jorge, enhorabuena, porque os lleváis este coche por parte de Rebeca. Aplauso
Thank
para
you.
Ellos.
Thank you,
Rebeca. Tú.
Thank you.